got to tell yourself he's worthy this morning. Hallelujah. He's worthy this morning. When I think of the goodness of Jesus, I know it might sound cliche to some folks, but I truly think of the goodness of Jesus and all that he's done for me. My soul rejoices and cries out, hallelujah. I'm looking at a whole bunch of testimonies in the house this morning. Amen. I'm looking at some testimonies in the house today. Amen. They don't know your story. They don't know your story. Because you got breath in your body. He said, let everything that have breath, praise the Lord. If he's kept your life, give God some praise. If he's kept a roof over your head, give God some praise. If he put food on your table, give God some praise. If he makes you a clothes on your back, give God some praise. If he gave you a reason to push the strength and help, give God some praise. If he blessed your children, give God some praise. If he blessed you on your job, give God some praise. If you see an increase in your business, give God some praise. If they have nothing but an idea that God can do anything but fail, and he has blessed me time and time again, I got a reason to give God some praise.
Praise the Lord again. Amen. We truly honor the Lord this morning. We thank him, amen, for allowing us to come together in his house on this morning. Amen. We come to glorify the Lord today and just bless his great name for all the great things that he has done already for us. Amen. Come on, can we clap our hands and just thank the Lord for being real in our lives and being merciful unto us. Amen. We come to worship the Lord on this morning to celebrate with you all. Amen. For your 5th year anniversary. Amen. Thank you all so much for allowing us to be a part of that. Amen. Amen. We just want to help usher in the Spirit of God this morning. Amen. Right where you are, help us just lift up the name of Jesus. If you want to stand and worship, you can stand. Lift your hands. Just allow us songs to minister unto you on this morning. Amen. Hallelujah. Lord, you're welcome here. Hallelujah. You're welcome here. A wave offering, just thank you for being real this morning in your life, that you have the ability to wave your hands in his presence. Hallelujah. You.
You got to thank God for grace each and every day of your life. Because if it had not been for God on our side, truly, where would you be? Can you even answer, where would you be this morning? So every time we enter the gates of God, can we just open our mouths and lift our hands and say, Lord, thank you for grace this morning. Thank you for grace this morning. You're so kind. You're so merciful. You love. You are welcome here. You are welcome here. You are welcome here in the name of Jesus. We honor you. We give you great praise. Come on, one more time. Clap your hands for the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings, the great I am. Let them know you appreciate him. Hallelujah. Glory. Hallelujah. We're going to sing one more song, but we're going to get out the way. Amen. But allow God to be God. In the atmosphere, amen. Glory to your name, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Oh,
praise. Amen. Give God some praise. Give God some praise one more time. Hallelujah. I'm excited. I'm excited. I didn't wait till I got here and got excited. So tell your neighbor, I've been excited. I'm excited for what our God is doing in this season. I thank God for how He's moving and Restoration Outreach Ministries. Come on. First Lady Joyce Bailey, your voice is anointed, but your spirit is anointed. My. I knew she could preach. But she's a singer. A few things about Bishop Bailey, and I'm gonna ask you to come introduce him if you don't mind. I'm fine, you got it, okay. And the next person you hear after me would be the voice of our very own Wendy. Oh, amen. Our summons for this morning, amen. And then we'll hear the mighty, powerful, dynamic, anointed word from our God through the lips of Bishop Jerald Bailey. Bishop and I had some entrepreneurial experience in common. I had a lawn service, he has a lawn service, amen. It's called Bailey's Lawn and Landscaping Company, amen. And this guy, just like Ernest in the back, has grown his business and God has shown favor in his business. I watched him move from one church location to a new location, and I saw the work that your congregation was doing. He didn't have a whole bunch of contractors. I'm telling the whole story. He didn't have a whole bunch of contractors come out with, you know, trying to, you know, just do the work. It was the congregation in there. I mean, women too. A lot of them picking up heavy stuff, walking things out, sweeping up, remodeling. Come on, give God some praise. Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
I mean, restored that whole building, changed it, and it's kind of symbolic for your ministry. God has allowed the word of God you preach to restore others, to give people a different face look before God. Amen. That their walk completely look different from when they first walked in y'all doors. Amen. God has used y'all in a mighty and dynamic way. And don't worry about who come pat you on the back. Don't worry about who celebrates. Don't worry about who notice what you're doing. Amen. Because God said, you just save one soul. Amen. Come on. You get that one lost sheep. Amen. But Bishop, God has his hands on you, and I don't do this often, but your best days are ahead of you. And Lord, don't worry, opportunities that come to your way soon in the name of Jesus. God's going to touch your family in a dynamic and new way. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 I know what God is doing, Bishop. I see it. Many folk have seen your walk. They have seen your faithfulness. Amen. And one thing about it, I couldn't have nobody else come before you except somebody who's been through what I've been through, or who's been through what I might be about to face, so he can encourage us. Somebody say us. I invited him because I want him to encourage us, amen, to do the work of the Lord further, to be steadfast, unmovable on the battlefield for the Lord, amen, to be radical while living righteous. Amen. And I thank God for him because I know God had given me the right man. Somebody say the right man for this hour. Amen. Amen. Without further ado, let's point our hands to a bishop. Reach our hands to him and say, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Use this man of God this morning in a mighty way. We trust you for your power. We trust you for your word. And we trust you for the blessing, God. In the name of Jesus. Lord, everything he poured out in this hour, God, we pray that you pour back into him double, God. And Lord, we thank you, Lord, for the man of God who's going to speak your truth. That may we all give you the glory. That the best people, God, unashamedly say amen. Amen. Who should have to say amen again? Come on, give God some praise. Come on, give God some praise. Amen. Come on, give God some praise this morning. Oh, he's worthy this morning. Amen. He's worthy. Amen.
This man of God and woman of God and leader of this church. I'm going to ask if you all's praise team do mind backing me up just a little bit in just a minute. But as y'all come up, I just want to speak to Pastor to say Ephesians 1:11 says, "In him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will." But I'm just focusing on that one word about being predestined, because that means that he knows your name. He knows your name. And we know that no fire can burn you. No battle can turn you. No mountain can stop you. And I know one thing, that you are walking in your victory. Also know that the power is within you to sustain you for these 5 years, and for First Lady, for you to stand by his side for these 5 years. But I know sometimes in those 5 years there's been a name that you also had to call, and it's the name of Jesus. Anybody else know about the name of Jesus? Do y'all know that it's a precious name to call? We know that when times are high, you call on Jesus. When you say thank you, when times Lord, we call on the name of Jesus. Sometimes you just need a good friend, and that's the name that you want to call, is the name of Jesus. So there's just a song that says, "Oh, how precious is the name of Jesus."
Yeah.
And when you're
morning sharing with my brother and my sister in Christ. Amen. It has been a long, long time coming. Can you give me just a little volume? Say amen. Just a little volume. It has been a long, long time coming. I want to say that I met Pastor Rogers. One of my favorite places doing one of my favorite things. In a restaurant eating. Amen, somebody. And nothing like good food, amen. But come to find out, we were Facebook friends all along. And they approached me and we began to talk about ministry. And talking about ministry, our relationship began to blossom over the years. Amen. And even allowed me to come and serve the yard one time, didn't he? Fine. No, you didn't find me. But he gave me the bigger job, amen, to clean it up so he can maintain it, amen. But thanks be unto God for genuine people. Genuine men of God. I'm so grateful for Pastor Rogers and thinking about his journey, amen, from the AME church and now over here, the Word of Truth. God has been good. Anybody that know about pioneering the work, know that it's not easy. Sometimes you question God as to whether or not he truly called you to do this. Especially when you get in tough places. But I thank God that he has held firm to the commitment that what he has told God that he would do, he's done just that. So since the conception of this ministry, Pastor has been telling me, man, I'm going to get you over there to do anniversary, man. I'm going to get you over there to do anniversary. You know, COVID hit last year and did not permit us to really worship and fellowship as we truly did, wanted to. I got the phone call and he asked me, would we come? I said, sure, let me check some things, amen. We canceled our morning worship to come and worship with you on this morning. We don't have everybody here, but nonetheless, we're here with you. And we are supporting you. And I want to encourage you on this morning, Word of Truth, to stay on the wall. Don't allow anything or anybody to hinder your race and your work. I'm going to ask that you return with me to the book of Acts, 5th chapter. Verses 40 and 42. I cannot stand here without honoring my wife. Amen. She truly an anointed vessel. Thank God that she accepted the challenge and the charge to walk alongside me. Lady Rogers, you know it ain't easy being married to a man of God. Sometimes when everybody else make you mad, amen, he got to come to you and talk to you and keep you up all night long, amen. But nonetheless, it takes a special being to walk with a man of God, a very special being, and I'm excited about what God's going to do for the remainder of our lives together. Amen. I'm going to get into this anyway, Acts 5th chapter, verses 40 through 42. And they agreed with him, that is Gamaliel, Sanhedrin council, they agreed with him. And when they had called the apostles and beaten them, they commanded that they should not speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. So they departed from the presence of the council rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for his name. And daily in the temple and in every house, they did not cease teaching and preaching Jesus as the Christ. God, we thank you for this hour. Be found in your presence, sharing with our brothers and sisters in Christ. We pray today, God, for the fulfillment of your will and your word in our lives. We ask now, God, for the riches of heaven to invade our hearts. For the speaker word, God, that will make free, make alive, that will encourage, uplift, and enhance the lives of your people. I simply avail myself as your instrument. Work in me. Work on me. Work through me. Work for me. As I speak only what you have given me in Jesus' name. Let every believer shout amen. Amen. Take a seat with a shout.
Hallelujah.
So good to see you, my brother Seals. So good to see you. I want to talk to us from a subject matter on this morning, committed to the cause.
Yes, yes.
Committed to the cause. Everybody who says that they are committed to the cause are not necessarily committed.
Amen.
And or they are committed to the cause predicated upon either having their name called or being up front and being delegated some sort of authority that makes them superior to others. True commitment is based on one who has put forth dedication and loyalty above all else.
All right.
Because they understand the importance of fulfilling God's will.
Mm-hmm.
And word of truth on today, I come to encourage you just as much as I've come to encourage restoration about the importance of being committed to the cause.
All right.
It's easy to be committed. If you can just turn that off. It's easier. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
Ain't got much wiggle room, but we're going to work with it. Amen. It's easier to be committed when everything is well. It's easy to be committed to a full church.
Yeah.
It's easy to be committed when you don't have to do the work and the work has already been pioneered and done.
Mm-hmm.
And all you have to do is walk in.
Yeah.
And participate.
Yeah.
It's easy to be committed when you are not called above the call of duty.
Mm-hmm.
When you can just walk in and sit down and everything runs seamlessly around you. It's easy to do that.
Yeah.
But when it comes down to being involved and totally committed to the cause, many people question whether or not this is what they really want to do. We're not necessarily talking about life because we commit so much to life.
Uh-huh.
We commit to marriages.
Uh-huh.
We commit to mortgages.
Uh-huh.
Lord have mercy. Y'all talk to me and hear somebody. We commit to gyms, amen, and we don't even go, but yet we commit to them and they're taking money, amen, and we're wondering why things ain't going the way they should go. Commitment is a huge undertaking. And when you commit totally to God for some apparent reason, those of us who are in the church, we've taken our logic on commitment from the culture.
basically because we feel that as long as we commit to a thing, we ain't supposed to suffer in the thing in which we've committed to. And so long as you're doing right, all ought to be well. But I come to tell you that as many as live godly must suffer persecution. And I tell you, we see the disciples doing what they've been called to do. And that is represent the name of Christ at all costs. Many people in the church today, they're not necessarily committed to God, they're committed to the church. They're not committed to Christ, they're committed to the praise and worship team, they're not committed to God. They're committed to the pastor, they're not committed to God. They're committed to their membership. And what happens is when you have those type of people in the church, it causes the vision to suffer and the visionary to work harder. I'm trying to help you. We don't need you to get on board when everything has been done. We need you more while we're building so that we can collectively look back on what we've done and say, God, thank you that you allowed us to pioneer a work together. So that when others come in and they talk about how they've been watching you and how they've been following you, not even understanding what you had to go through. No, you ain't been following me. You just got on. Because understanding following me, you understand my struggles. You understand those who have come and those who have gone, and yet I've had to stay steadfast in doing what it is that God has called me to do. And that's what we're looking at in our text on today. After Pentecost, so much had gone on. And now the apostles are doing exactly what God has called them to do. They are pioneering the work of Christ in the earth to establish and to build the church, and they are being buffeted. They are experiencing all kind of affliction and conflict and adversity. And yet, watch this. They continue to move forward in commitment. I've seen so many people, amen, the first time somebody talk about them, amen, they're gone because of church hurt. God ain't talking to me. The first time somebody is reprimanded and reproved and set down and corrected, they are gone. But here are some apostles. Here are some disciples who knows what it is to be in, watch this, intense fellowship with Jesus. And Jesus to look them in the eyes and ask them, how long must I be with you, O ye of little faith? You've been walking with me all this time. You know exactly what it means to be committed to the cause. You've seen me open blinded eyes. You've seen me unstop deaf ears. You've seen me walk on water. You've seen me multiply fish and bread. You've seen this, and yet you are faithless. It's hard to stay committed to God when those around you aren't committed to anything greater than themselves. And you cannot commit to something greater than yourself. You are influenced by selfish nature. It can't be about you and about him. If it's about God, then it's not about self. Then sacrifice must be involved. So that we understand that living for God, it means that we're going to experience some persecution. We're going to experience ostracism and criticism. We're going to experience abandonment. Lord, have mercy. Some of us got abandonment issues. The apostles knew right well that God was calling them to something greater than themselves, and they committed to the cause. Jesus says, watch this. If you follow me, before you take up your cross, deny yourself. And follow me. He says, follow me and I'm going to make you fishers of men. In other words, there was something greater that I'm calling you to. You've got to commit to something bigger than yourself. And the Bible says now that after the first century church is established, the apostles, they are being persecuted. In so much that while they are out doing the very work of God, that the Bible says they were bringing people and laying them in the apostle's shadow. And people were being healed and delivered. And the reason we don't see that kind of work being wrought today is because we ain't committed to fasting. We ain't committed to praying. We ain't committed to biblical studies. We ain't committed to doing the things of God. We're more committed to what is going on in the culture than we are committed to the things of God. The Bible says, as a result, they were thrown into prison. And being thrown into prison, an angel came by way of night, Lord have mercy, and rescued them and told them to go stand in the temple and preach all the words of life. And the Bible said the very next morning they went and they stood in the temple, and as they were in the temple they were preaching the word of God. And the Bible says now comes the king and the head of the Sanhedrin council and the high priest, and they sent to loose them from prison. And the Bible says when they got there and the prison's doors were locked, and the soldiers were standing there guarding an empty prison. And they came back and they gave the word to the king, and the Bible says they had indignation within them so that they wanted to kill the apostles. And when they found them again, they were standing in the house of God preaching the word of God. I come to tell you, every once in a while you're going to have to learn how to swim against adversity. You're going to have to learn how to swim against a conflict and all of the things that come against you. And the Bible says here, they want to destroy the apostles. And Gamaliel stands up and says, do these men no harm. Because if this work is of God, you'll be found fighting against God. Somebody shout, they were committed. So committed means, watch this, feeling dedicated.
Yeah.
Feeling dedicated and dedication and loyalty to a cause.
Mm-hmm. Ah, that's good.
Activity or a job, watch this, wholeheartedly dedicated. Mm-hmm. Some of us, watch this, we ain't dedicated to God for nothing but him blessing us. Lord, if he give me the increase, if he give me the job, amen, if he give me the wife, if he make my body whole, I'm committed to him. But when God is calling on you, Lord, have mercy, when you don't feel like going, when you don't feel like preaching, when you don't feel like teaching, when you don't feel like singing, when you don't feel like doing his will, because how people treat you, yet and still, you're committed to the cause to go above and beyond because you're dedicated and loyal to him. When you commit to something, you make a pledge through obligation to fulfill that in which you have committed to.
Yeah.
So commitment is the guts and the inner workings of a vow.
Yeah.
Which only option to satisfy is fulfillment.
Yeah.
That's why the Bible tells us in Ecclesiastes 5th chapter, verses 2 through 6. He says, be not rash with your mouth. Let not your heart be hasty to utter a word before God, for God is in heaven and you are on earth. Therefore, let your words be few, for a dream comes with much business. Why do you think that you're always trying to see what it is that a dream means? You're always trying to get somebody, Lord, have mercy, to tell you what's going on. He said, a dream comes with much business. And it's hard to interpret dreams sometimes. Lord, have mercy. And he says, watch this. And a fool's voice comes with many words. When you vow a vow to God and do not pay it, he has no pleasure in fools. Pay what you have vowed. Because it's better, Lord, have mercy, that you not vow than to vow. Can y'all hear me?
Yes, sir.
All right. I'm going to preach without this mic. Is that all right?
Go ahead, sir. Amen.
It's better
to
not make a vow than to make a vow and not pay it. Somebody shout, because God, has no pleasure
in
fools.
In
and the reason that commitment is at an all-time low and ineffective in the church today is because people are committing
with their emotions.
Yeah.
You got people in the church today who are committing with their emotions. They're committing with their lips. Jesus says, watch this. You speak well of me with your lips, but your heart is far from me. There's no commitment in the heart today. There's no commitment in the mind today. There's no commitment in the soulish realm today. And an emotional commitment is a shallow commitment. And it is not to be trusted.
Yes, sir.
Stop worrying about people talking about that they're here and they're there and what they're going to do. You got to learn how to watch their actions.
Come on.
Their actions speak louder than their words. So long as they feel good and everything is going well, they're committed and they're all in. But the moment that something arises contrary to their emotional commitment, it retards and obstructs their commitment. The moment that something arises contrary to their emotional commitment, it retards and obstructs their commitment. Ask you, Lord, what happened? Why is this person backpacking? I thought you said, for God I live and for God I die. And the moment you were faced with death, you said, I'm just going to live. Lord, have mercy.
Let the Lord use you. Come on.
Every once in a while, you are going to be faced with difficulty and adversity. You're going to be faced with conflict, but you cannot give up and you cannot bow out, because this is what you've been called to.
Yeah.
I wish I had some help in here today. The obvious is true. They are not spiritually led because they refuse to be Bible fed. You can't be led by the Spirit if you ain't eating the Word. Y'all don't want to talk to me in here. An empty commitment is the result of an empty container. Y'all don't want to talk to me in here. The reason people are making empty commitments because they are empty conduits. They're not carrying much, so they can't commit to much. When you find people who are committed to the cause, you don't have to look for them. People who are committed to the cause will beat you to the work. Bible says when it was that Moses called for an offering, the Bible said that the people were giving, and watch this, they had met their quota. Watch this, and he told them to stop giving, but they kept on giving. That's commitment. That's above and beyond. Oh, look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, you got to be committed to something greater than you. An empty commitment is a result of an empty container. Wherever there is a weak commitment, you will no doubt find a weak Christian. Wherever you find a weak commitment, you will no doubt find a weak Christian. Somebody shout, I ain't talking about you. Just looking and asking. I'm just asking, are you weak or not?
Yes, sir.
You will no doubt find a weak Christian who have not been influenced or impacted by the loyalty and the drive of community. You are a product of your environment. When you get around commitment and you want commitment, you are influenced by commitment. Whenever you're around lackadaisical people, it means, watch this, that you've got to make a decision of your own volition that you're going to either, watch this, push them into something greater, or you're going to become a product of what you're around. So today our text highlights and points out not half-hearted, weak or emotional commitment, but rather wholehearted, bold, and unquestionable commitment. Men committed to a cause greater than themselves. Y'all ain't talking to me anymore. That's why he told Peter. He said, Peter, you can't live by that thing. Because if you live by the sword, you and that not so. And obviously, preacher, Peter caught a hold to what God was saying. Because this is Peter in the text. Talking about we rejoice that we were beaten and suffered shame for the name of Christ. That's why I can't get with people in church talking about, watch this, they acting funny. Who acting funny?
Come on.
And talking about me. Amen, somebody. They didn't speak to me. Did you speak? Commitment goes beyond what we see and what we say. It is based in what we do. Y'all ain't talking to me here. See, when people commit to the church today, you really almost don't have a clue as to what they're committing to. You don't know, watch this, if they're committing to the music, the preacher, the youth ministry, the location, or their family and their friends. You don't know if, watch this, they have ulterior motives or hidden agendas, or if God has truly ordained them to be a part of the ministry. And this is why Jesus vetted his disciples. And knew each one of them personally and intimately. Jesus dealing, watch this, with the rejection of followers in John the 6th chapter, verse 7. And he says, watch this, to his disciples, did not I choose you? Did not I choose all 12 of you? And one of you is a devil? Jesus says, I'm so committed and secure in who I am. I'll let you walk with me. As wicked and rogue as you may be, I'm confident in who I am. You can't discourage my commitment. When you're committed, you can walk with devils and not be affected. When you're committed, vultures can fly all around you and not touch you. When you're committed, you can have parasites all around you, but they won't harm you. When you're committed, God will allow you to be thrown in a fiery furnace and you will not be burned. When you are committed, you can be thrown over into a hole like Joseph and you will not die. Look at somebody and shout, when you're committed. Some of us don't know real commitment.
Come on.
Commitment causes you to go deeper in prayer. Commitment causes you to examine yourself. Because if you don't watch it, you'll mess around and think that it's about you. You ain't got to believe me. Come here, Lucifer. I don't usually talk to you. But I want to ask you a question. What was it that God called you and allowed you to become the covering cherub that you got full of yourself and became so vain that you thought it was about you? And God had to destroy you. He said he allowed you to walk through the fire. But because you became arrogant and conceited, he brought forth the fire out of you to consume you. Every once in a while, you got to examine yourself. Because you ain't so searching much. No, you have not arrived. That's why when you start going through, you can't be saying stuff like, anointed folks don't go through that. That's a lie. The greater the anointing, the greater the attack. You're not called to God and exempt from struggle. You're not exempt from suffering and persecution. You cannot just ride the high waves. Things don't get low. When they get low, you got to have some fire in your belly. To bring things back up where they need to be. Look at your name and tell your neighbor, we got to be committed to something greater than yourself. I'm almost out of here. Don't blink, I'm almost out of here. I'm almost out of here. Somebody shall commit me. Oh, God. Jesus says, didn't I choose all 12 of y'all? I know what I'm working with. I know who I'm working with.
Come on, tell the truth.
I know what's around me.
Come on.
And it cannot affect me. This is because Judas, watch this,
was connected to Jesus for selfish gain. Pastor, watch those of you, those who get around you for selfish gain.
Yeah.
Watch it. Watch it. Those who are connected to Pastor, help him watch what he needs to be watching. Help him watch those in whom he needs to be watching. Y'all ain't with me. I hear Peter saying, go and choose me 7 full of the Holy Ghost. Watch this. He says, bring them to me and let me lay hands on them, because I can't stop doing what I'm doing to do what y'all need to be doing. He says, just bring them and I'll lay hands on them and the Holy Ghost will fill them so that they can be delegated authority to do what I can't do in this moment. Look at your neighbor, tell your neighbor, I'm committed.
I'm committed.
He was committed and connected to Jesus for selfish gain. It was an emotional commitment that will end in eternal separation. If Judas would have known that he was going to die and go to hell, he would not have been so caught up in the temporal success of this earth. What does it profit a man to gain the world and to do what?
Lose his soul.
It really means to lose himself. You got everything, but you've lost you. If you're going to follow Christ, you must crush your emotions, build your will, and surrender your mind. Can I say it again? If you're going to follow Christ, you must crush your emotions, build your will, and surrender your mind. Can I have just 10 more minutes? Conflict exposes commitment to a cause. Conflict exposes commitment to a cause. First time somebody is met with conflict, you will see just how devoted and committed they are. I've seen it. If you've never seen an anointing under pressure, let me introduce you to it. Come here, Elijah. Everybody has forsaken you but me. Is it a lie? I got 7,000 who ain't even bowed to me. That's the anointing under pressure. Watch this. The anointing under pressure is when you don't kill all Jezebel prophets at the contest at Carmel. And everybody saw your works. And then all of a sudden, a whisper comes in your ear. If your life is not like theirs by this time tomorrow, and you take your head, run and put it between your knees. The mouthpiece of God hiding in a mountain. God says, watch this. What you doing here? You're supposed to be rendering the words of life. What you doing here? Why are you so afraid? How can you kill who she's postured and not have the power to kill her who has a bounty on her head from the Lord? Lord, have mercy. Every once in a while, amen, somebody shall be anointed under pressure. Anointed under pressure will cause people to run and hide in the caves. Amen, somebody. The anointed under pressure, come here, Moses, let me talk to you. The anointed under pressure, Lord, block my name out, kill me, and let them get in because it's too hard for me. This is too much for me. That's the anointed under pressure. But when you understand who God is, He can keep you even under pressure. Conflict exposes commitment to a cause. Conflict exposes commitment to a cause. Those who hold, who fold rather, and are affected by conflict become paralyzed and numb to commitment in the face of adversity. I'm almost finished here, y'all. Because they think, watch this, self over sacrifice. Pastor Rogers, if you're like me, you've heard hundreds of people tell you how committed they were until conflict and adversity arose. Somehow people become more prophetic and spiritual
when they don't want to suffer and or be persecuted for a cause.
They become very prophetic and spiritual. They'll become more prophetic and spiritual than you. They've been hearing from God for a long time now. In the midst of adversity. They somehow can hear God telling them that the time is up here. That he wants to do something greater in their lives somewhere else. That he's pushing them out. Because watch this, they've outgrown the teachings of this ministry. This amazes me. Because as long as we had sunshine, they were down for the cause. These type of people are dangerous to the church and the vision. Because they're unstable in all their ways. True spiritual commitment requires us to commit to a cause greater than ourselves. It can never be self over sacrifice. If we're going to be effective in our calling, commitment for the greater good of a cause is committing yourself to a greater purpose for your life outside of work and domestic living. I'm tired. I'm working all night and I'm doing this. And you ain't the only one working.
Hear me now.
You ain't the only one got kids. You ain't the only one got bills. You ain't the only one got issues. But can you commit yourself beyond that? The disciples knew, watch this, and they prepared themselves to suffer for the name of Christ. They did not regard their lives as their own, and even in the face of conflict and adversity, they set their face like flint to do the will of God. They weren't involved, they were committed. Can I say it one more again? They weren't involved, they were committed. I know I can I say it one more again? They weren't involved, they were committed. I'm almost out of here. If we want eggs for breakfast. All the chicken has to do is lay eggs. But if we want bacon and sausage, the hog's got to give his life. You see, those who are willing to give their lives understand the difference between involvement and commitment. Revelation 12 and 11 declares, watch this, we overcome the enemy by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony, and we do not love our lives, watch this, and we do not renounce our faith, even in the face of death. Our text tells us, watch this, that the disciples rejoiced and counted themselves worthy to suffer shame for the name of Jesus. And after doing so, they went right back to doing what they had been forbidden and strictly commanded not to do. What if somebody tell you not to do something in the name of Jesus, which the culture is doing right now? Don't preach the name of Jesus. We don't want to hear that gospel. We don't want to hear that because it's too mean. I'm almost finished. Somebody shall preach the name of Jesus anyway. The very thing that had gotten them thrown into prison, watch this, and beaten in the first place. When you're committed to the cause, nothing shakes you. Nothing breaks you. Nothing intimidates you. Because you belong to something bigger than you. The disciples understood the power of the word. That's why, watch this, they never underestimated the words of Jesus. They knew the necessity of struggle, conflict, and adversity. Don't worry about them going down over there. We're going down over here. For his sake. So they welcomed it. In closing, watch this. Matthew 5 and 10 through 12. Jesus declares to his disciples, blessed are you when they revile and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my name's sake. He says, rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in the heavens, for so persecuted they the prophets. I got to get out of here. Listen to me. Word of truth. You got to be committed to the cause. God's allowed you, watch this, to survive 5 years. You've still got the pulse of God in your veins. You know how many people started and were finished in a year? How many people who started and were finished months after the inception of their ministry? Don't worry about the number. God will add to the church. You do your part and stay committed whoever don't show up, and whoever don't do, you don't put that pressure on your pastor. Commit yourself to the cause. Because God is calling you to something greater. Come on, clap your hands and give God praise. Come on, come on. You can do better than that. Bless you.
Oh, come on, give God some praise, amen, for that word, amen. Ask your neighbor, are you committed to the cause? Come on, look, wait for an answer. Ask him, look, are you committed to the cause? We have to be committed to the cause. Let's stand to our feet for a moment, boys, just for a quick second. Come for a second, Bishop. That was a dynamic word. Amen. Amen. Committed to the cause. And I took it in ministry. Amen. I took it as a parent. I took it as my marriage. Yeah. Man, whatever you do in your job, be committed to the cause. Because we not, what I got from that bishop, we ain't looking for recognition from men. Not from flesh. From the Lord. Amen. Yeah. Come on now, we're talking about committing to the cause.
Yes.
I said this recently. And I hope it makes sense. The reason why I got committed to the cause, if God ever took me any time that I expected, because I feel I don't live alone, like we choose to come back home tomorrow.
Come on.
I don't want to buy line of my obituary.
Come on.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. I'm serious. Amen. Because sometimes we exaggerate to make folk look good in front of people.
Yeah.
But we never held people accountable while they was living so they can look better before God. I want you to look good on paper.
Come on, man.
Rather than you look good in reality.
Good, man.
You see what I'm saying?
Good.
Not committed. My wife will tell you, everybody I talk to, I know I got some friends, they think I'm crazy because I tell them like it is.
Come on,
son. Because we can be A1 since day one, but at the end of the day, I can't sit here and let you go the wrong way on purpose.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
So my commitment go beyond this church, this pulpit, this podium, these four walls.
That's right.
I just want to ask you, how far do your commitment go?
Good question.
How far do your commitment go? Are you more committed to your job than you are to your children? Do your boss see you smile more than your husband or wife does?
Good, sir.
Who are you committed to?
Good, man.
When you really say you love the Lord, do you love everybody the Lord send your way?
Come on, sir.
Are you a picker and a chooser? How committed are you? You talking about my whole ministry in 5 years. But you was talking about my life too.
Come on, man. Come on, let's go.
And I thank God you had to open that door because sometimes I allow uncommitted people to stay around me because they ain't have nobody at all.
Yeah.
I allow uncommitted people to stay around me because I feel like I needed somebody around me.
Come on, man. Come on, man.
And we were kids out here, but I know our heads are still developing. Right now, he might get unconscious. But when I tell you, he knew the Kool-Aid, he knew the flavor, he worked there. Man, you know what kind of jewel you got in here?
Yeah.
Rest of us. If I would have listened to my flesh and not my spirit, we wouldn't have got that word today. But when you're committed to the cause, he'll send the right people, the right sources, resources. He give you the right vision.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
But only in your commitment will you be obedient.
That's right.
Yeah.
That is right. That is right.
We can't be pseudo atheists. We can't be part-time believers.
My Lord.
We gotta be committed.
Yeah.
When we talking about the last night, the poor family sang that night, and poor mama said, "If this is my last time singing with my soul, this is my last time seeing you. If this is my last time."
Come on.
How committed was I in that moment?
Come on. That's good.
Mama.
That's good.
Man, you preached a great word. This is a great way to celebrate our 5-year anniversary, but also to propel us to our next season.
Thank you.
You know, sometimes you can love people, you can respect people, then you hear that encounter and say, I love you more.
Yeah.
Bishop, I love you more. Because only God can give you that word. Amen.
Amen.
I thank God for the word of truth, man. Let's come on, give God some praise and worship. Come on, give yourself a hand clap of praise.
Yeah.
Restoration. Outreach Ministry. We're going to do offering two different ways today. Amen. We're going to raise restoration separate from us because they bought the whole church. This is their service Tuesday morning. Amen. And so the man of God, Quincy, is going to come around. No, he's going to come your way. Okay. Restoration, prepare your tithes and offerings. Word of truth, you'll be next. Prepare your tithes and offerings. Bow heads. Heavenly Father God, we thank you, Lord, for the word that went forth with power and conviction. That hope it leads to correction. God, we thank you, Lord, for tugging our hearts to be committed. Now, God, let us be more committed as this service go further to the giving of your ministry.
Yes, Lord.
God, we say you give seed to the sower. And for everybody you gave seed to, God, let them be obedient and committed to what you asked them to give this morning. We thank you right now, God, that the works in us that you have allowed us to do can only be funded by your people.
Yes.
So men and women, God, prepare your tithes, your offering, your love gift, amen, this morning, and do it with a heart of commitment.
Yes.
That the work your ministry has started can continue to go forth, that God may receive the glory.
Yes.
May little become much in your sight, God.
Yes.
That it go beyond these walls and bless those who are in need of your community.
Yes.
In both ministries, mindful to you all praise, honor, and glory for your word to be praised. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. Prepare your gift. Amen. Already. Amen. Thank you, sir. Thank you, man. Let's close up the offering. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for the tithes and offerings and monetary gifts that have been given. In Jesus' name, we pray that the blessing of God say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's stand to our feet. I need prayer warriors right now. My sister, Pastor, you saw his family's need real quick. Their apartment, their home just got caught on fire. Amen. Amen. Let's lift them up there. Their daughter was at home and she got out okay. She's fine. Amen. Let's pray for him. Amen. Amen. Let's pray for him. The ministry's going to be there for him for sure. I'm going to see what I can do to help him out right now. Amen. Thank you so much for the word that went forth, Bishop. Thank you so much, Restoration. Outreach Ministry, man. Thank you so much for being to us. Thank you, praise team. Thank you, musicians, man. Drumming you some serious as well. If you don't mind, real quick. Just give us about 3 minutes of your time. Our praise team have put together something, and they surprised me this morning. But I love them. Can y'all just please celebrate them every morning? Yeah. Amen. But I tell you, it's unfortunate. Amen.